Am I audible to all of you? Just write in the chat box. Okay. So I am sharing the screen of today's class. All of you see the presentation slides? Okay, so let's start the today's class. In the last class, we already studied the software and basically its characteristics and its types. The two most popular types of software are system software and application software. All of these topics in detail we discussed in our last class, and we also see their differences. So this is the last topic we studied in the last class, the comparison between system software and the application software. So in today's class, we are going to discuss the performance issue. So basically the performance issue is of the CPU. Although it is said as the computer performance, but basically it means the performance of the CPU, the central processing unit. So basically the computer performance is the amount of work accomplished by a computer system. So this is the definition of computer performance. So what is the amount of work accomplished by a computer system is termed as the computer performance. The word performance in computer performance means how well is the computer doing the work it is supposed to do. So it basically depends on the response time, throughput, and execution time of a computer system. So these are the three factors on which the computer performance is dependent on. So the response time is the time from start to completion of a task. So basically this includes the operating system overhead, waiting for input output and other processes, accessing disk and memory, time spent executing on the CPU. So these are the four factors on which the response time is dependent. The other factor is throughput. So throughput is the total amount of work done in a given time. So this is the definition of throughput. So moving to the next slide. So CPU execution time. So CPU execution time is the total time a CPU spend computing on a given task. So it also includes time for input output or running other programs. This is also referred to as CPU time. So basically the execution time is very much important for calculating the CPU's performance. So performance is determined by execution time, as performance is inversely proportional to execution time. So this is the relationship between the computer's performance and the execution time. It is inversely proportional to the execution time. So this is the formula. So performance is basically 1 upon execution time, because it is inversely proportional. So it means that performance of machine A upon performance of machine B is equal to execution time of machine B upon execution time of machine A, as it is inversely proportional. So it gives that processor A is faster than processor B. That means execution time of A is less than that of execution time of B. So therefore, performance of A is greater than the performance of B. So this is the relation between the CPU's performance and the execution time. So all of you understand it? Just write in the chat box so that we can move further. So how many participants are there? Okay. So basically, in the last week, Wednesday and Saturday are holidays. So our class was not conducted. And now onwards, our class will be held on Wednesday and Saturday. So the formula we discussed, let's take an example based on that formula. So in this example, you have seen that machine A runs a program in 100 seconds and machine B runs the same program in 125 seconds. So we need to calculate the performance of machine A with respect to performance of machine B. So according to the formula we already discussed, the performance of machine A upon performance of machine B is equal to execution time of machine B upon execution time of machine A. So by equating this, we get the value 1.25. So that means machine A is 1.25 faster than machine B. So by using that formula, we calculate the performance, or we compare the performance between the two machines. So these are the other formulas. So the time to execute a given program can be computed as execution time is equal to CPU clock cycles into clock cycle time. So this is the formula for evaluating execution time. So since clock cycle time and clock rate are reciprocals to each other, so we need to replace this clock cycle time with clock rate. So this formula can be rewritten as execution time is equal to CPU clock cycle upon clock rate. So whatever is given to you depends on that. You need to use the formula. If clock cycle time is given, then you can use this formula. And if clock rate is given, then you can use this formula. So this is these are the formulas for calculating the execution time of CPU. So the number of CPU clock cycles can be determined by, these CPU clock cycle can be determined by using this formula. So the formula is number of instructions per program into clock cycle upon instructions. So as you can see, this can also be written as instruction count, means number of instructions per program can be rewritten as instruction count into clock cycle per instruction can be written as CPI, means clock cycles per instruction. So this is the formula for calculating the CPU clock cycles. So just you need to remember this. Maybe 2-mark question can be asked in your examination based on the formula. So you need to just put this formula and put the values corresponding to it. So moving to the next slide. So basically the execution time, so these formulas can be written as instruction count into CPI into clock cycle time. and it can be rewritten as this, because clock cycle time is reciprocal to clock rate. So we can also divide it. So the unit of CPU execution time are, so these are the units. So basically the CPU time is equal to, the unit is basically seconds per program. But as we need to write each and every unit of this, then instruction count can be, the unit of instruction count can be instructions per program. Then CPI is cycles per instruction, and hence clock cycle time is seconds per cycle. So as you can see here, as we write all their units, then as you can see, these instructions and these instructions can be cancelled, and these cycles can be cancelled. So whatever left is seconds per program. So basically the unit for CPU execution time is seconds per program. So this is the unit, and the process by which we can derive it is explained here. So all of you understand it? Just write in the chat box. Okay. So moving to the next slide. So how to improve performance? So these are some of the factors by which we can improve the CPU performance. So in order to increase the CPU performance, we need to first decrease the CPI, means clock cycle per instructions, by using new hardware. So this is one method by which we can increase the CPU performance. We can decrease the clock cycle per instructions with new hardware. The second method is we decrease the clock time or increase clock rate by reducing propagation delay or by using pipeline. Actually, the pipelining topic is in your unit 5th. So when we discuss when we will study the unit 5, then we will going to discuss the pipelining concept. The third method is decrease the number of required cycles or improve instruction set architecture, which is also abbreviated as ISA or compiler. So by using these three methods, we can improve or increase the CPU's performance. So basically, by using these methods, we can improve CPU performance, or we can improve the execution time of the CPU. So that's all for the CPU's performance, and we will go into discuss the next topic, which is assembly language. So all of you understand it? So may I move to the next topic? Just write in the chat box. Okay. So I am just sharing my slides of assembly language in just a minute. All of you see the slides of assembly language? Just write in the chat box. Okay. So let us discuss the assembly language, and it is very important from examination point of view. So before discussing assembly language, let us first discuss the machine language. So basically, the machine language is the low level programming language. So machine language can only be represented by zeros and ones, which is also termed as the binary form or the binary digits. In early days, when we have to take a picture or show data on the screen of the computer, then it is very difficult to draw using only binary digits, that is zeros and ones. For example, to write 120 in the computer system, it is represented as this. You already discussed the binary conversion in when you studied the digital electronics subject. So it is very difficult to learn. So to overcome this problem, assembly language is invented. So basically, assembly language is invented in order to overcome the problem which was faced by using the machine languages. So moving to the next slide. So assembly language. So basically, the assembly language is more than low level language and the less than high level languages. So it is in intermediary language. So basically, the assembly language is in between the low level and the high level languages. So assembly languages use numbers, symbols, abbreviations instead of zeros and ones. So, for example, for addition, subtraction, multiplication, it uses the symbols like add, sub, and mul, respectively, for addition, subtraction, and multiplication. As you can see in the diagram, that assembly language can be converted to machine language by using the software tool known as the assembler. So basically, the points you should note that the assembly language is in between the machine language or the low level language and the high level language, and the software which is going to use in the assembly language is known as the assembler, which is going to translate the assembly language into the machine language. So all of you understand it? Just write in the chat box. Okay. So moving to the next slide. So programs written in assembly language are compiled by an assembler. So basically, assembler is a software tool. Every assembler has its own assembly language, which is designed for one specific computer architecture. So every assembler has its own assembly language. Sometimes assembly language is called a low level programming language because there's nearly a one-to-one relationship between what it tells to the computer to do and what the computer does. So in some books you can also find that assembly language is also treated as a low level language, but basically this is not fully correct because assembly language exists between the low level programming language and the high level programming language. But if you find the assembly language is called low level programming language in some book, then you cannot get confused with it. In general, one line of an assembly program contains a maximum of one instruction for the computer. So as you can see, for adding two numbers, we can write that add R1 comma R2, as we already discussed when we study the instruction format. So one line of assembly language program contains a maximum of one instruction for the computer. It cannot we cannot get there that in one line we can calculate the addition, subtraction, multiplication. The computer cannot work that. In one line, it can calculate only one instruction. So, moving to the next slide. Now the comparison between the machine language and assembly language. So this is very important. So basically the machine language is only understood by the computers. But in case of assembly language, it only understood by human beings, not by the computers. So this is the main difference. The second difference is in machine language, data only represented with the help of binary formats like zeros and ones, decimals, octal, hexadecimal. All of you studied this in detail electronics subject. But in case of assembly language, data can be represented with the help of mnemonics such as move, add, sub, etc. So these mnemonics can be very much understood by the human beings and not by the computer, because for understanding the computer's language they use the machine language, but for understanding it better for the humans we use the assembly language. So we are using mnemonics in assembly language like move, add, and sub. When we are moving or addition or separating the data. The third point of difference is machine language is very difficult to understand by human beings, but assembly language is easy to understand by human beings as well as compared to machine languages. So the fourth point is modifications and error fixing cannot be done by machine language. Whereas in case of assembly language, modifications and error fixing can be done by the assembly language. The fifth point is execution is fast in machine language because all data is already present in binary format. So as the data is already in binary format, so execution is fast, or you can say the fastest in the machine language. But in case of assembly language, the execution is slow as compared to machine language. The last point of difference is machine language is hardware dependent. So basically, the machine language is hardware dependent. But in case of assembly language is the machine dependent and it is not portable. So we cannot port one assembly language in another computer system. So every computer system has its own assembly language. So we cannot port it. So this point is very important. So every system has its own assembly language, and we cannot port the assembly language. So all of you understand it. These differences are very much important from examination point of view. What is the difference between the machine language and assembly language? Just write in the chat box so that we can proceed further. Okay. As we discussed the low level language in assembly language, so we can also discuss the mid level languages and high level languages as well. So basically the mid level languages provide some high level abstractions to make the programmer's life easier while still providing access to low level operations. So as it exists in the mid level, so it can interact with the high level languages, and it can also interact with the low level languages as well. So they are often used to write operating systems So they are sometimes called system programming languages. So this is the other name of mid-level languages, system programming languages. The next point is programs written in mid-level languages can perform as well or nearly as well as programs written in assembly languages. So both the programming languages, both the mid-level languages and the assembly language performs the same. So examples of mid-level programming languages are C, C++, Ada, Rust, and etc. are the examples of mid-level programming languages. In some books, they are written C and C++ as also the high-level programming languages. And in some books, they are written as the mid-level programming language. But basically, these mid-level programming languages are useful to build the operating systems. So basically, most of the operating systems are built on the languages of C and C++. So these are the examples of mid-level programming languages rather than high-level programming languages. So moving to the next slide. So let us discuss the high-level programming languages. So high-level languages provide abstraction to low-level operations, which allow the programmers to focus more on describing what they want to do and less on how it should be done. So basically, in high-level programming language, the programmer basically deals with what the programmer wants to do and less it deals with how the program is actually doing that work. So programming this way is more convenient and makes program easier to read at the sacrifice of low-level control. So basically, in the high-level language, the programmer is concerned on what the programmer wants to do. The third point is programs written in high-level languages never match the raw speed and efficiency of the program written in assembly language. So basically, the high-level language execution speed is lower than the assembly language assembly languages. So example of high-level languages include Python, Java, JavaScript, and Lisp, etc. Other languages are the examples of high-level programming languages. So all of you, I think, understand the differences between the low-level, high-level, mid-level, and the assembly language. So all of you understand their differences? Just write in the chat box so that we can move further. Basically, in the first unit, in your syllabus, they have written only the assembly language. But basically, in order to understand the assembly language, we need to also study the low level, mid level, and the high level languages as well. Because sometimes they are asking the question of their comparison and their differences. So although they are not written in your syllabus, but sometimes the question may ask to compare between the low level or the machine level language with the assembly level language. So chances are much more, and in many previous year papers, this type of question asked in your university examinations. So moving to the next slide. The advantages of assembly language. So basically, it requires less memory and execution time. It allows hardware specific complex jobs in an easier way. It is suitable for time critical jobs. It is more suitable for writing interrupt service routines and other memory resident programs. So these are some of the important advantages of assembly language. So all of you understand it? And I will share these slides to you. You can take notes from these slides. So that's all for the assembly language. And I am going to start a new topic, which is known as the stack. I think all of you heard this topic. In your third semester exam, there is a practical lab for data structure and algorithm. Did you study the stack and queues in the data structure and algorithm practical lab? Just write in the chat box. Okay, so I think your seniors studied it, because in their syllabus the data structure and algorithm lab is there. But I think in new curriculum the there will be no lab in for data structure and algorithm. So anyways, I am just discussing the stack topic in today's class, and in Saturday class will be the last class of unit 1. And the rest of the topics, queues and subroutines, we will going to study in Saturday's class. So let us discuss the stack. So basically, this is the topic of data structure and algorithm. But we are going to study this topic from the computer application perspective. So basically, you can see that. The first topic is, or the heading is, what are stacks in computer memory? So I am not writing the stack as well. I am writing just the what are stacks in computer memory, because we are discussing the stack from the computer applications or the computer architecture point of view. So the memory stack are linear data structure used to store data in computer's memory. So basically, the stack is a form of data structure, and which is the linear data structure. Its type is linear, used to store data in computer's memory. So items in a stack are inserted or removed in a linear order and not in any random sequence. So you cannot insert or remove the data element according to yourself or according to your desire. It only insert and delete the data in a specific order. So in this case, a technique called LIFO is used. So the full form of LIFO is last in, first out. So whatever we inserted last, it will go into to delete first. So this is the stack. So basically, the stack is somewhat like this, and these are the separations, or you can say these are the cells of the stack. So you can number it 1, 2, 3, and 4, and so on. So basically, if we want ABCD words to insert in the stack, like ABCD, just as an example, if we want ABCD words to insert in the stack, so as we insert it, so by using this, we can insert it. So you can say the A will go to the first place, then B goes to the second place, then C goes to the third place, and D goes to the fourth place. So we are inserting in this order. In the linear order, like if we number it 1, 2, 3, 4. So these are the positions of the stack in which these elements are stored, or these characters or these alphabets are stored. But when we try to remove these alphabets, then the reverse order is applied. like D is going to be removed first, then after that C is going to remove, then after that B is going to remove, and at the last we get the A, which is removed from the stack. So that's why the term is called the LIFO, last in first out. So here we inserted the D alphabet at the last. You can see where we inserted the D alphabet at the last, but we removed the D alphabet first. So it is called as last in, whatever the element is last inserted, it going to be first out. So last in, first out. So here D is inserted last, but D is first out. So this is the main terminology of stack. And this data structure is predominantly used in computer architecture because of this property. So all of you understand it? Just write in the chat box. Okay. So moving to the next slide. So when a stack is accessed, has items inserted or removed, it is done in an orderly manner using LIFO. So LIFO is the property. So LIFO is the acronym which stands for last in, first out. So the example we discussed in our previous slide, the diagram, you can also understand it better by using this diagram. So the computer uses this approach to service data requests received by computer's memory. So LIFO dictates that data inserted or stored last in any given stack must be the first removed. So here you can see from the diagram that this is the form. The stack is doing these operations by using two operations. First is push and the second is pop. When a user want to insert the data, then he need to push the data into the stack. So push and pop are the two operations which is performed on the stack. So push is for insertion and the pop is for the deletion operation. Pop is for deletion. So as you can see, here you can see the insert queue. So here, as the push operation is performed, so first you can see the light blue color of the tray is inserted first, and you can see it at the bottom. The first the tree inserted, it goes at the bottom. After that, the green one, then the dark blue, then the purple, then the orange, and then the red. So these disks are inserted one over other. And once you need to delete, or you can perform the pop operation. So once the data is deleted, then you can see here the red color disk is popped out or deleted first. After that, the orange color disk is popped out second, and so on. So this is the property of a stack by which it can be used in many places in computer architecture as well as in data structure and algorithm. So I think all of you understand it. So moving to the next slide. As we already discussed from the previous slide figure, the push operation. So the push operation involves inserting data items into the stack. The push operation adds plates data items to the plate dispenser stack. So we are taking the example of the previous slide. So the first plate is pushed to the bottom of the stack, with all subsequent plates following in order after it. So the first data item inserted is the most inaccessible and positioned at the bottom of the stair. So whatever we inserted first, it will go into insert or stay at the bottom of the stack. So this is the push operation. The push operation is used for insertion of the data. So moving to the last slide, which is the pop operation. So the pop operation involves removing data item from a loaded stack. In order to perform the pop operation, we need to first push the data elements into it. Otherwise, the stack is empty. So in order to perform the pop operation, first push operation has to be performed on that stack. In our plate dispenser illustration, the last plate data item added is positioned at the top of the stack. As we already see in the previous example, this data item is popped out of the stack as the first item to be removed. So whatever we inserted at the last is the first item which is going to be removed from the stack. So think of a spring loading system at the base of the plate dispenser. So just we are recognizing the example which we already discussed in the last slide. So it pushes the stack of the plates upward each time a plate is moved. So in memory, items continue to be popped out in that order. So basically, you need to remember the pop operation is for removing the data item, and the pop operation must be performed after the push operation. Otherwise, the stack is empty, and as the stack is empty, so there is no need for pop operation, because in the stack there is no data item, and the pop operation cannot be performed on an empty stack. So I think all of you understand it. So just write in the chat box. So in Saturday's class, we will going to cover up our last two topics, queues and subroutines, and that will be the last class of unit 1. So thank you very much for attending today's class. So please leave the meeting.